Remain standing for our first hymn on page 121. There's a wideness in God's mercy. Page 121. Affirmation of faith this morning is the Apostles' Creed on page 881 in the back of your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. Welcome to Mount Zion United Methodist Church. Great to have everybody with us this morning. Do we have any first-time guests with us this morning? If so, please raise your hand. See any first-timers? I do see some down here that we haven't seen in a little while, though. Very good to see y'all. Nice to have you this morning. Yeah. Good to have Lee and Autumn with us. Welcome. Let me direct your attention to the flowers. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Nice to have Eddie and Paula with us.
Yep. I had jumped in on that with Eddie and Paula. We loved having you guys here for a few days. But one of the things we do here at Mount Zion, if you live to 80, and yesterday you turned 80, you get a song over here, Dr. Thomasina, performing the piano. She did a song.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Eddie. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Eddie, and nice to have you and Paula with us. Let me direct your attention to the flowers. The flowers are to the glory of God and in memory of their sweet lily, placed with love from Mara and Ray McCune. And thank you very much for the flowers this morning. Any announcements this morning? Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. It's gotten a little chilly at night lately, so we are in need of a few things in the pantry. People have been asking for socks, and we have zero. So we can use some socks that prefer long, black socks. And while you're shopping for socks, if you see some gloves or blankets, that would be good too. Getting to be that time of year. But socks for sure if you run across them. Thank you.
Thanks, Carol. Please bring in that stuff. It is definitely getting colder in the mornings and evenings around here, so we can continue that ministry to hand that stuff out. Matt.
But I got an email this week that came in my inbox from Sparks Incorporated, and it was these Sparks that you bought 10 rows. We've got to get us started with that. And they were asking if we could start putting stuff over there starting at the end of the month here in the beginning of November. We're trying to cook enough for at least a dozen bags by Thanksgiving. If you need a list of items you're looking for, you might see some back in the best book. I can give you one. If you want to learn more about the life on a charity, they're in a lot of different states. They're well made and well respected.
Man, I have two bags. Remind me, I have two bags. I'm a glutton for punishment. I got two bags.
Thank y'all. Please continue to bring those items in. If you need a list, there's some in the narthex, or you can see Matt to get those. So thank you for heading that up for us, Matt.
And we have Shelby.
Thanks, Shelby. That's 5 o'clock tonight, 5 o'clock for Family Fun Night. Any other announcements? If there are no more, we'll have a special presentation from Ann.
Good morning, everybody. We do have a special presentation this morning, so if I could get Sophie and her mom and dad to come down with her. And if I could get Lincoln and his mom and dad to come down with him, I would appreciate it. Forgive me for standing down here with y'all. I'm usually up there, but Miss Ann can't do steps right now. A little difficult. Okay. Look, y'all are a fine-looking crew this morning. So you guys have reached a major milestone. And what that is you have promoted up in Sunday school to the third floor. So you guys have gone from the middle to the top, like you're in the high rise. So you're in Miss Marsh's class, and you've got Miss Lisa up there, and you are upstairs with all the big kids. I mean, how awesome is that? Like you've moved up, really. Like, I mean, I'm probably still on the second floor myself, so... So with that, we'd like to give you guys your very own Bible for you to take home and to learn your verses and stuff in, because you're going to start learning a lot of verses, and you're going to have some favorites that come to you. So we want you to have your own Bible so you can read those and learn those, okay? So Sophie, here is yours. And Lincoln, here is yours. And we are so proud of you guys, and we cannot wait to see what you... like come up with out of these with your favorite verses and let us know what they are. And we love you very much. So thank you.
Congratulations. Congratulations, kids. And I just wanted to add, you know, you can use those for your own growth, your own learning. And then this is the Bible I got when I was in, when I entered third grade. I got this at St. James United Methodist on August 30th, 1987. And now I teach my kids about God's love and grace, and I use this same Bible. So this is treasure. That is such a treasure to have those Bibles. So I'm just so happy that we got to that y'all have those now and have that treasure for your lives. Congratulations.
Thank you guys. Y'all have a good day.
Thanks, Ann. Any prayer concerns this morning? Or praises? Yes, sir, Steve.
Yes, I'd like for y'all to pray for Marcia. Tuesday, she's going in to have back surgery. If she passes all the pre-tests Monday, all day Monday, we got to go to different doctors to get the okay, because we didn't find out until Friday morning that she was going to have this surgery. When they looked at her MRI, they said, "You're going in for surgery Tuesday." So this is kind of quick on us, but we would appreciate all the prayers y'all could throw up for Marcia, because she needs them all.
Yes, sir.
And I do too.
Marcia Lamb.
If I don't have it Tuesday, it'll be the following week for sure.
All right. Yeah. We'll pray this week just in case. Yes, ma'am. Liam? The Waters family? Yes, sir. Joyce? Becky Simonton and Tommy Swinney? Josephine Swinney? Sean Flynn?
Andrew?
Don Cobb and Barbara Prater?
The Wise and Lowndes family?
The Wise and Lowndes families? The Panther family? Yes, ma'am. The Courtney Cox family. Yes, ma'am. Rosa? Jose Andres Mendez. Matt?
I did want to say a praise. I asked a few different groups in church to pray for my schools, and I saw some real positive change on Friday, the first time. So just be worth being praying. And then I got two requests. My good friend has a little daughter named Emma. I have some seizure issues.
Karen Lowry and Emma and her family. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Virginia Morgan, the Short family.
Carl Becker. Carl Becker. Daniel.
Chad Buffalo.
Graham. Yes, ma'am. Traveling Mercies. Any other prayer concerns? Josh has a praise. I'll turn it over to him.
Yeah, I've got a praise I do want to share. You know, our Project 1213 is just moving along so well. Every Sunday we're able to give food to some families in need, and I just want to praise God for the team that he's put together and that's working together so well. Mar McCune just helped us hooked us up with a new connection for getting produce to people, and we're able to do that. And so just the ways that is just growing and we're able to help more, I'm just so thrilled about. And I just praise God for that. And also, if you could use some extra groceries, we're giving away about a week's worth of groceries every week. And if you're a member of our church family you'd be put on the waiting list, but please, that ministry is, we want to help and we want to get you on that waiting list. So let me know, let Carol Cobb know, let somebody know. But I just praise God for the way that is just rolling along and for what Mar brought to the table. It's just a great praise. Thank you. Let's go to our Lord in prayer.
a wonderful God, Lord of all goodness, Lord our help. God, you seek the last, the least, and the lost. And you seek even us, our souls, our lives. Lord, thank you for this day that you have made and the privilege and the opportunity to rejoice and be glad. Lord, may we not retreat into hiding into ourselves and miss all the opportunities to rejoice. May our knowledge and hope in you so pervade our being that we lose every single bit of fear that we might have of crying out to you. When we have an opportunity to approach you, our Savior, our Healer, our Maker, our Redeemer, our Lord. May each and every single one of us believe that your healing and light are possible for us and that we need not cower in the darkness. Shine your light on us. Shine your light in us. Shine your light through us so that we tear down walls and break through roofs so that we can bring your light to those who dwell in darkness. May we walk your way without stumbling. Lift up in your light today, O God, all those names we've voiced, all those that we keep in the silence in our hearts, all those conflicts, those matters that we wrestle with, not knowing quite how to voice them. Lead us in the light of Christ's resurrection, that we may have the courage and confidence to serve in the name of Jesus, who so taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
We'll continue our singing on page 117, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. We'll sing verses 1 through 4 and 6. 1 through 4 and 6. Page 117, please stand.
Oh,
ushers, if you all would come forward to take this morning's offering. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of being able to give, Lord. Lord, take what we give and through the power of your Holy Spirit, multiply what we are able to do with these offerings, that through the power, through the working of your Spirit, all might see the awesome power and the glory of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 through 52, on page 47 in the New Testament of your pew Bible. They came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. Word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. At this time, we'd like for the children to come down for the children's message.
Josh couldn't be here today with me, but he told me to tell you hi, and he'll see you tonight. I have some questions for you. Have you ever heard that word gospel? Yes. Do you know what it means? No? Okay. It means good news. Have you ever gotten good news in your life? Like something excited? Like, can you give me some examples? Your birthday, yeah, that's always great. What else? Like going to Disney, maybe? Oh, yeah, that's so exciting. Like, and this state has great news yesterday. You know what that is? The Braves won. Yeah, right? Braves won, and they're going to the World Series. Yeah, that's awesome, isn't it? He's going to take you? Oh, that is awesome. Those are great news. Those are really great news. I'm going to tell you about something that we used to do in Nicaragua. I used to work in a ministry there, and we used to make piñatas. Do you know what a piñata is? So, but there is a small community, so it's like a big family. We all know each other. So it's like, and like we will decide to make a piñata like today, and we'll say to one kid, oh, we're going to make a piñata, and that kid will make sure everybody in the whole community knew about the piñata, and we will have a bunch of kids coming to the ranch for the piñata and to get candies, because they were like making sure their friends will get some candies. But I want to talk about a better news that we have. Do you know which one is that? Oh, the better news we can get is about Jesus. Yeah, Jesus rose from the dead, and he came and died for every one of us. So we can all go where? To heaven, right? One day. So those are the best news that we have in this world. God himself sent Jesus to earth to die for us, for the thing that we have done wrong, so we can have a place in heaven. And you know what he wants us to do? He wants to share those news with everyone, with all the world. It doesn't mean we have to go to other places in the world. Well, for me, it has. I've been here. I'm here now. And I've been to Africa. And I have told this news to kids there, too. And I'm telling you here in my second language, because, you know, Spanish is my first language, right? So it's, but I'm here telling you those great news. Jesus died for each one of us so we can all can go to heaven. You know what? How we can do that? Putting our faith in Jesus, right? For all of us, for kids, for adults, for everyone. And he tells us that that we should share those news. Now I'm going to read a Bible verse for you. It say in Mark 16:15, he say to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. That means share the good news of salvation. Right? Yeah? So now we know what the gospel means, right? What does it mean? Good news. Yeah, good job. Okay, now we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this wonderful time that we have with these kids. Thank you for the opportunity that you give me to share your word with each one of them. I pray that you bless them and keep them safe, and always they can always remember how much you love them, and they can always share that love with other people. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thanks, Rosa. This time we ask you to stand up, greet your neighbor, tell them God loves you, and go Braves.
It was indeed a great ball game last night. I got to go to the game last night, and I didn't take, I'm sorry, Martian, I did not take you, but did you enjoy your apple? I got you an apple. That's right. But you know, I didn't get home till late. And, you know, it's one thing if you fall asleep. It's a whole other matter entirely if the pastor falls asleep. But I don't think that's going to happen. Anyway, I was there at the game. I was there at the stadium, and I was looking at it as we were on a ramp, walking up to where our seats were. And you know, when you're in a stadium like that, you get to see kind of all the inner workings of it. And I was just marveling at just how much work it must take to just build a structure like that. Just all the wiring here and all the, of course, all just the planning, the architecture and the schematic and all that, just to get it all planned out in the first place, and the plumbing and just everything and everybody kind of communicating and working together just to build that structure, that stadium. It just took a lot of work. And there's a lot that we take for granted, I think, about work. Today, October 24th, 2021, today is the 83rd anniversary of the day that the Fair Labor Act became enforceable law. Now, what the Fair Labor Act did was establish a national minimum wage. It prohibited oppressive child labor, and it established a 40-hour work week, which we all just kind of take for granted, of course. You work 40 hours, where it said anything over that would have to be paid time and a half. And that was only 83 years ago that all became law, and it is. It's stuff we all take for granted now. I mean, of course we have a minimum wage. Of course you're not allowed to hire children to work an adult's job. Of course a full-time job is full-time, is 40 hours. It's crazy to think otherwise. And yet it wasn't all that long ago, and it wasn't true, and it took a long time coming. In 1791, carpenters went on strike for a 10-hour workday. And then throughout the Industrial Revolution, it was 80 to 100-hour workdays and work weeks were common. That's what you had to do. If you wanted a job, you'd better be working 12 hours a day. And it took a really long time for that to change in America. There were a lot of protests. There were people killed. And then, you know, people called the movement for an 8-hour workday socialism and said it would take away our freedom. And then others said, well, it would ensure our freedom not to be exploited. But it wouldn't have happened if people hadn't spoken up. Right, there were a lot of people who were asked to do way too much work for way too little pay, who said, have mercy. And then they were told to be quiet, right? And they could have done that. And a lot of them probably did. A lot of them probably did, just be quiet. But some of them thought, maybe I ought to just say it a little louder. Have mercy. And I imagine that was real hard to do sometimes. It's hard to go against the grain. It's hard to, you know, to stand out, really. If you know people aren't going to like what you say, to have to make waves, to have to upset the apple cart, that's hard to do. You know, don't do it. But all that does, when we don't do that, when we're unwilling to do that, all it does is just keep us in the same place. It stops any kind of change from happening. When we become more focused on what we imagine other people want us to do and how other people want us to behave, rather than pleasing God and getting help from God in our life, then it's a problem. When we care too much about fitting in and just going along with the crowd, and when we stop caring about what it really means to follow Jesus, then there is a problem, because it's worth it. It's worth it to stick your neck out. It's worth it to ask for God's help. So in the scripture today, Jesus is traveling on. He's been in Jericho preaching. He's been showing where the reign of God is. And now he's set to leave. And he and a crowd around him, they're going on the 18-mile uphill journey to Jerusalem. And his disciples are there too. And it's a large crowd. And so I imagine there must have been a lot of anticipation. All these people following Jesus, something is happening. There's excitement. It's all building up to something. And his disciples don't know exactly what. They're arguing. They're giving their opinions about who is best and who's going to sit on the throne next to Jesus. And of course, Jesus clues them in. He says, if you want to be the greatest, you have to become a servant. And if you want to be first, you have to be the very last. You have to be a servant of all. But they keep following. It's all building up to something. And the crowd is huge. There's an excitement in the air. Let's follow Jesus, everyone. Let's see where he's going. It's worth taking a look. It's worth going along. Give it a go. See where Jesus is going. And suddenly, amid the hubbub and the crackling excitement of that crowd, that voice. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. That voice. They'd heard his name before. It was Bartimaeus, that old blind beggar. Of course, most of the crowd didn't know his name, probably. He was just the annoying old beggar who sat on the side of the road outside Jericho. And now most of the time, people would just ignore him. But people were in a too good a mood. They were too excited to just ignore him that day. They were very excited. So they got a little angry that day. Be quiet, shut up, you blind old crazy beggar. The crowd didn't want to hear it. You know, a crowd is a bunch of people. And that's what people do when they're in a crowd. They go along with each other. But he said it again. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still. He said, call him here. And we kind of know how the rest of the story goes at that point. The crowd who was trying to silence Bartimaeus just a minute ago now supports him when they see now he's got Jesus' attention. Oh, you got to get on Jesus' good side, right? Get up. He's calling you, Bartimaeus. Get up. Go to him. And he takes off his cloak. He springs up. And Jesus asks him, what is it that you want me to do for you? My teacher, let me see again. And his vision is restored and he follows Jesus. Bartimaeus was blind and he was made to see. Jesus cured him of blindness. There's no doubt about that, right? But the real lesson, or at least the real lesson I want for us today, because I love this text. I mean, you could preach 9 sermons from this text. But the lesson I want to pull out today is why he was healed in the first place. Why Jesus stopped for this old blind beggar on the street. Jesus stopped because Bartimaeus wouldn't shut up. No matter how much the crowd wanted him to be quiet because he was obnoxious and his voice was grating in their ears, he spoke up. And it was worth it for him to speak up. The crowd tried to shut him up, but that didn't matter. It was worth it. And for Jesus, it was worth it to stop. And so we can be like Bartimaeus, and we can ask for help even when people say it's futile, it's not going to get you anywhere. And we can be like Jesus sometimes and listen to those who are crying out, but we absolutely cannot afford to be like the crowd who just goes along to get along. Because it's worth it. Because Christ is worth it. Because again, all too often the crowd says it is not worth it. Forget about it. Someone else will take care of it. You see people and you say, well, just go easy on yourself. It's not worth trying. It's not even worth trying. I mean, it's so easy to be like the crowd. I've done it. You've done it. I don't have time to care about all this stuff. People just need to suck it up. That's life. Deal with it. I do enough already. We probably don't have the whole story. There's probably something else going on there. What kind of scam is this? Pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Can't somebody else do it? Somebody else can help. It's all that stuff we tell ourselves from time to time so we don't have to listen. But that's not the gospel way. That's not the way of Lord Jesus. And there is another way. We can look to the perseverance and the persistence of Bartimaeus when we see people crying out for help. When you go earlier, you go earlier in the book of Mark. If you go earlier, there's the story of Jesus in Capernaum. This is the beginning of chapter 2, the very beginning of chapter 2. There's a story of another crowd. It's another crowd there in chapter 2. And so many people are gathered around Jesus, there was not even any room for them in the house. And there's another man that needs help in this story. He's paralyzed. He can't walk. People are having to carry him. He needed people carrying. Four people carrying this man. This is how, in the Common English Bible, this is how verse 4 reads. It says, when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And after having dug through the roof, they let down the mat on which the paralyzed man lay. Now again, let me repeat that in case you missed it. When they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. They cut a hole, they made a big hole in the roof just to get this man to Jesus. When people are crying out for mercy, are we passing by? Are we just passing by and wish they'd shut up? Just ignoring them? Even saying sometimes, be quiet. Or are we rushing to them and picking them up and carrying them, breaking a hole in the roof, just so we can get them past all the noise, past all the junk, to sit at the feet of Christ? Because sometimes there might be something in our very own house. Sometimes there might be something in the very structures that we put up that get in the way of people's access to the Lord. And we just decide, well, it's not worth it. It's just not worth the trouble to get them to see Jesus. Sometimes we have to break through the roof. Sometimes we have to break through the roof so that people can see Jesus, because it's worth it. And the church cannot forget that, right? There are people crying out today. There are, in all sorts of ways, there are so many people crying out today. People who are crying out for racial justice. There are people crying out for like vaccine justice, right? People crying out about voting rights, about the election in this country. There's stuff going on with elections in this country. There's people and millions of people right now crying out for mercy in the workplace. People are crying out, right? And they're crying out for mercy. And if we just say that every single one of them is doing it because they're lazy, then I'm not really sure we're listening. If people are seeing the church, the people who have pledged their lives to follow Jesus Christ, if people are seeing the church saying, it's not worth it, just keep your mouth shut, then they're going to decide that it's not worth it. And they're going to decide that Jesus is not worth it. Now hear me. I'm not saying we have to agree with everything that people are saying. I'm not saying that at all. There's a lot of people crying out that I disagree with. But what I'm saying is we need to hear people's cries. We need to hear it on a deeper level. The souls of the people who are crying out for Jesus. The same thing I talked about a couple weeks ago, listening on a deeper level, listening for the soul. Bartimaeus, when Jesus was first passing by, Bartimaeus wasn't asking for sight. You know, you look at it, when he's first passing by, he probably just wanted a coin in his cup. But Jesus listened. There's something deeper going on. It was worth it. It was worth it for Jesus to speak up. And now we can either pass by like the crowd, or we can break through the roof and we can listen and take heart and listen to people's cries. One of the things I love about Mount Zion is that people are willing to break through the roof so often. I mean, I'm just talking to some of you right here, really. But now, you go to other churches and tell them to drive for how long some of y'all drive to get to church. They say, well, no way I drive that long. No way. But you break through the roof because you want people to see the Lord. It's one of the things I love about this church. And y'all who don't have the really long drives, y'all break through the roofs in your own ways. I'm not, just bear with me here. But it's worth it. It's worth it to get people to sit at the feet of Christ. It's worth it to go against the grain. If people had never gone against the grain, none of us would ever be in here. If Peter and John had not stood before the people and told them about the resurrection of the dead, I mean, they were arrested and put in custody, but thousands believed. If the apostle Stephen had not told the people of Israel at the high council how the prophets had foretold the coming of Christ, how he'd been murdered and betrayed, and they dragged Stephen out of the city and stoned him to death. But it was worth it. Where would we be if Paul hadn't decided that it was worth it to be beaten and flogged and dragged and imprisoned for the sake of preaching the gospel? Because it was worth it. And of course, in our story today, Jesus is just leaving Jericho because he's on his way north to Jerusalem, where there's another crowd who awaits him with Pontius Pilate, with the cross. And he's going there because he knows you are worth it. That it was worth it for Jesus to die for you. To break through the limits, to break through our limits, to break through the roof of all our understanding and doubt and fear, to break through all that, because it is not the will of the Father that even one of His little sheep should ever be lost. To pierce through our darkness, to say, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Amen. See, that's where all this comes together. People crying out for justice, people crying out for mercy, and a blind man named Bartimaeus, who probably sounded really annoying, but who thought it was worth a try to cry out for the mercy of Christ, no matter how much people wanted him to shut up. It all comes together at the cross. What's worth it in your life? What's worth it? What is worth asking God's help for, even though you may have given up? Maybe you've been fighting with a member of your family over some stupid thing that happened years ago. But they don't think it's stupid, or maybe you don't think it's stupid, and everyone just seems to overreact. And like maybe they're totally, totally, totally in the wrong. Or maybe you are. But is it worth it to let them know that you love them and you care for them, even though you may get nothing in return? What's worth it? Maybe you've been around people who just say some absolutely stupid, ignorant stuff. And you kind of feel like being quiet. It would be easier. But is it worth it to stand up and say something and stand up for what's right and decent? You may be in a situation where you're lonely and you're scared and you have way too much pride to admit that. And so you're just stuck being lonely and scared where nothing ever changes. Maybe it's worth it to ask for help. Because Jesus says you are worth it. Break through the roof. Ask to be healed. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Amen.
Our closing hymn is on page 348. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. We'll sing the first and last. Page 348, please stand.
May the light of Christ break through the roof, pierce into the darkness. May you walk in His light, know His light, and know His infinite and wonderful mercy for you. Amen.